Hello everyone. You're probably wondering what the show is going to be about, so let me explain. This show is going to take a look at the world of animation. More specifically, animation that cannot be classified as anime. Now, don't get me wrong, there are animes that I do enjoy out there. The thing is, as many good animes as there are out there, there are an equal amount of anime reviewers out there. And not enough reviewers that look at the world of animation from things that aren't anime. That's why I'm doing this. Also on this show, I will be covering television shows, but I will not cover any show that has not finished its run yet. Meaning until the final episode airs, they will not be covered on this show. Well, I think I got the annoying explanations out of the way, so with that being said, my name is CM Waters, and this is Watercolors. To begin with, let me take you into the world of Hanna-Barbera. In 1957, after the closure of MGM's animation studios, William Hanna and Joseph Barbera, best known for their works on shorts featuring characters such as Tom and Jerry and Droopy, formed their own company, HB Enterprises, later to be known as Hanna-Barbera Productions. From 1957 until the mid-2000s, Hanna-Barbera brought forth a variety of characters that would be remembered to this day. Among one of the more well-known ones was Yogi Bear. Yogi would get his start on the Huckleberry Hound show as a secondary feature, but the popularity of the character would allow him to become a breakout star. Though Yogi did this first, we call this phenomenon the Fonz Principle. Anyway, over the years between 1960 and 1991, Yogi Bear would star in numerous TV shows, a bunch of TV movies, and even a feature-length theatrical movie. No! No! Not that one! The good one! There we go. Point being, over the years, Yogi Bear proved to be a big success for Hanna-Barbera, making them millions of dollars in cash. So, in 1991, leave it to the brilliant geniuses at NBC to find a way to screw it all up. Ladies and gentlemen, I am about to give you a series that not even the most staunch of defenders of the 1990s can give good justification for. Here it is, Yo Yogi. Ah, Yo Yogi, a series that you could easily tell was very much the product of its time. A show that unabashedly realizes its purpose in life, to try to take the successful formula that was used in Muppet Babies and try to apply it to some of Hanna-Barbera's more well-known characters. Now don't get me wrong, this isn't the only time Hanna-Barbera would try this. Later on, they would do the same thing with the Flintstones and Scooby-Doo in this subject that I like to call juniorification. But it still could be taken as a pure rip-off, and unlike those shows, Yogi, I feel, dropped the ball big time. How? Best way to take a look at this is to look at the origin episode, which is actually the 9th episode in the series. What the hell? Okay, first off, we have to start with the theme song. It's not great, but not horrendously rip-your-own-hair, if you have it, bad. At the very least, it gives you a generalized idea of the show's premise. But there's one thing in this show, that opening, that has gotten to me. What the hell was that about? That voice comes right out of left field, and it never appears anywhere else in the theme song. Just odd. Oh well, at least they didn't try to go the rap route like other franchises did at the time.
The aerial bots are taking their shot. Some of both blasts and combaticons. They can all change and be rearranged to form a super robot superior.
Let's go!
Anyway, getting to the origin episode titled Yo Yogi. Yeah, you know you're in for quality when you can't even bother to think of an original title for your origin episode. We find that Doggy Daddy is opening up the Jellystone. Wait a second! This is a juniorification show, isn't it? Meaning that all the characters are supposed to be made into kids or teenagers, and all the characters get proportionally de-aged if they were older. So why is Doggy Daddy, who in every previous multi-Hanna-Barbera crossover show has been the same age as the rest of the cast, now much older than the rest of them? A little consistency, please! Anyway, as I was saying, Doggy Daddy is at the grand opening of the Jellystone Mall, along with his son, Augie.
Right you are, entrepreneurial pop of mine.
Okay, Augie, there's a difference between being a son happy to be with his dad, and then there's some deep psychological disorder. Then again, you are a Hanna-Barbera character. If you don't have some type of character disorder, then you aren't memorable. Just look at Shaggy and Scooby's eating disorders. So while this whole thing airs on TV, Yogi Bear mopes that he doesn't have the money for any food to go to such the mall. But of course, that's solved due to plot announcement that will be free samples at this grand opening.
Food for free? That's for me, maybe.
At the mall, we're introduced to the other three main characters, Cindy Bear, Snagglepuss, and Huckleberry Hound. As they come in, they talk about this wondrous new hangout of theirs.
It's the latest spot to see and be seen.
And I can see all the latest movies at the Jellystone Super Movieplex already.
What a Jim Dandy place to rewind and unlax.
If y'all gonna lollygag, I'll never get to check out the new fitness center.
And I'd hate to miss browsing at that there sports port.
Jellystone Mall. Just think of the opportunities.
Oh God, Cindy's gonna start singing Material Girl, isn't she? Thankfully, we're saved from such a musical pain fest as we meet one of my favorite characters of all time to earn child. Dick Dastardly and Muttley. Alright, go ahead. Snicker and chuckle about Dastardly's first name. Let's get it out of our systems. Okay, are we done? Let's continue. Dastardly in this series isn't really that much different than he was in the others. I mean, sure, the stakes aren't as high as, say, winning a race or catching a messenger pigeon during the war, but the fact remains he wants to be a troublemaker, as evidenced by the first thing that he does in the show.
That's my spot, see? Just where are we supposed to fall? Try, I'll be!
Well, I'll be. Bees!
Okay, Doggy Daddy, I know you're new at this, but here's the thing. If you're going to put trees in your mall, maybe you want to, I don't know, make sure there are no bees in the thing? I mean, come on, I know the rest of the population besides the humans are animals, but that doesn't mean every animal is going to be friendly here. Anyway, rather than leaving the survival of the kids from being stunned to, say, mall security, it's up to the kids to try various ways to get out of this problem. The first attempt seems to work until...
Uh-oh, looks like the table's done turned.
You know, this show had more scenes of the kids getting beaten up by picnic tables. Might have lasted more than one season. Meanwhile, back at the main plot of the episode, we meet Major Smith, or Officer Smith, talking to Doggy Daddy about being the mall security.
With this Eye in the Sky 5000 security cart, I can monitor every corner of the mall.
When did this show cross over into the Jetsons all of a sudden? Smith proves to be pretty bad at basic competence to start, as it's not him, but Augie that realized that the mall has a flying picnic table!
Oh my gosh! The Invisible Bandit!
Oh yeah, I forgot to mention this back in the Yogi scene. Apparently somebody called the Invisible Bandit is going around stealing everything in the mall. Trust me, for this episode, and this episode only, that's important. Anyway, Smith manages to catch up with Yogi and the crew after they're dunked in the lake. Upon being accused of being the Invisible Bandit, or hiding him, Yogi shows grace and respect to the law, then be benefiting of a character of his leadership standing.
Never mind that. Where's the Invisible Bandit?
I haven't seen him.
Oh, a wise guy, huh? I'm taking your name.
Only if you promise to give it back.
That does it!
Wow. I never realized it until just now, but Yogi Bear is kind of a douche, isn't he?
You're banned from this mall for life!
Poor Yogi.
Looks like he's got a major problem now.
Oh, of course the series couldn't end that quickly. No, while all this goes on, Doggy Daddy and Augie are taking a tour around their new little plaything. Of course, to get the plot proper finally going about halfway into the episode, the Invisible Bandit manages to snag off with Doggy Daddy's cane. Rather than chase the cane himself and try to get it back, Thuggy fights back with the most powerful force a multimillionaire can use. Greed.
Reward of anything in my mall to the personages who catch my cane!
You may want to reword that, Doggy Daddy, because I can easily see a scene like this happening.
Thank you very much, citizen, for finding my cane, the second most prized possession to my son. As promised, I can give you anything in my mall that your heart desires.
Yeah, I want the deed to the mall.
What was that again? I don't think I heard you right.
I said I want the deed. After all, you did say I could have anything in the mall, right?
Oh yeah, I did, didn't I? Well, in that case, let me just go get it right out of my safe. I shall be right back.
Okay. With the promise of a reward, both Dick Dastardly and Yogi Bear are quick to jump on the idea. The others, not so much as the whole table incident. But since Yogi is, as he says,
smarter than the average bear,
he finds a quick and easy way to get some help.
Well, I guess that means we give up the reward then. Like a free membership at the Svelte Pelt Fitness Center? All the bats, baseballs, and bolos a kid could carry from the sports fort. A lifetime pass to the Jellystone Super Movieplex. But hey, what do you care?
Ah, Yogi Bear, proving that age-old tradition in the world. When altruism fails, avarice prevails. Such great morals this show is teaching us. After a 3-minute sequence of chasing, Yogi manages to use a fill-in for Old Faithful to catch the cane, thus gaining the kids the right to have whatever they would like. Yogi, showing a less greedy nature to things, probably because there's no food involved, tries to get the rest of the gang to join in on figuring out what about this clue he found. Sadly, the Pandora's box of greed has taken hold of the group.
I vote for the Bo Paxton cross-training football bat.
Heavens to Rambo, no! Lifetime passes to the movies already!
No, football bat!
Movie passes!
Football bat!
Movie passes!
Tom, then it's settled. A fitness center membership for me. I'll be the belle of the mall.
Now wait just a Papa Peck a minute.
No way, just say even.
You know, technically, shouldn't it be Yogi who decides on the prize that they go for? Since, you know, it was actually his doing that got the cane back! Stupid greedy brats. Also, what the hell is a football bat? Anyway, Yogi in the meantime tries to solve this mystery. So would that make Boo Boo into Yogi Scooby? And uses Smith's future tech chair to get a close look at the microchip. You know, I'm having a hard time deciding on this. With this high-tech chair, this is either a James Bond plot or...
This is starting to sound like a bad comic book plot.
But as Yogi is checking the chip out, Dick Dastardly suddenly comes in and swipes the thing, trying to get some type of payment. Knowing Yogi only had about 15 cents in his pocket at the start, I don't exactly know what Dick Dastardly was planning to get. But then again, Dick Dastardly isn't the smartest villain in the world, as he still hangs onto the chip as being pulled away. It's also pretty apparent that Muttley didn't learn anything as he hangs on to Dastardly as they enter the diabolical, twisted lair of a store owner in an ugly suit. You're not gaining any credibility with me, show. Okay, that's assuming that there was any credibility to get from you in the first place. The villain is Bombastic Bobby, whose evil plan is... You know what? I'll let him tell us.
My electromagnetic dots have been placed on thousands of items at the Jellystone Mall. With my master degenerator, I can easily deliver the goods to myself. Once I've stolen everything, nobody will go to the mall, and shoppers will have to buy from me at incredibly inflated prices.
Okay. This may not be the worst villain plan ever created, but is Jellystone's economy so bad that the only two areas to buy stuff are a mall and a barn run by Dr. Wily's kid brother here? While Yogi tries to sneak out and discover more, you know, rather than call the police or something, unless Officer Smith is the only officer in this world, Boo Boo is sent to get the rest of the gang to help out. They don't buy Yogi's theory, given the fact that Yogi 90% of the time seems to be the only competent one out of this whole series, until they start to see various things floating away from them.
Yogi was right!
No, really?
And you wonder why he prefers food over you. Back at Bombastic Bobby's, dastardly tries to save his own ass.
Listen, Bobby, how about teaming up with me? I have lots of friends in very low places.
Kid, just because you have, or had since Bobby stole it from you, a high-tech bicycle that does not make you on level to negotiate with the guy with the high-tech electromagnet. Stick to tossing bicycles at beehives.
Threat! Threat! And double threat!
Yogi tries to be stealthy, but his skills are thwarted by a conveniently stacked pile of toasters. Yogi is caught by the villain and I'm guessing gonna be made into a floor rug, I don't know. But...
Yo Yogi!
Yes, I forgot to mention this during the whole picnic table thing, but apparently every time the group is successful at something or charge into battle, they shout the title of the show.
Yo Yogi!
Yo Yogi!
You're not G.I. Joe and you never will be! With only a few more minutes to spare till the end of the episode, they go on their brave and heroically cunning plan.
Excuse de mio, Steven Snagglebird, famous Hollywood director here. And I want to film the life story of the Invisible Bandito.
Now I know what you're thinking, and while this normally wouldn't work, keep in mind these are cartoon characters we're talking about here. Hence, they only followed one of the major rules in the cartoon character rulebook. No matter how poor and idiotic your disguise is, a villain will fall for it. Seriously, how do you think Bugs Bunny survived almost 70 years or more? With a quick little hockey game, the villain is caught and the Dave is saved. But wait, what does that leave the rest of the crew?
I am making you junior members of the mall security force.
And from now on, you're going to follow my orders.
You can't be serious, can you? In a mall that has a movie theater, a food court, a park, waterfalls, a geyser, chairlifts, and everything else, out of that whole park, you only have one security guard. Doggy Daddy, you are a terrible business person! So, that was the origin story of Yo Yogi. Final thoughts? Very poor execution of already wasn't a great idea to begin with. The whole idea of taking well-known and beloved characters and not only reducing their ages, but putting them in a setting that confines them seems to step in the wrong direction. Consider previous Yogi shows. He was either in Jellystone Park, where he could easily get a ride out of the park if he needed to, or he was already in a situation out of the park touring the world. Here, he's confined to, while admittedly a big one, a mall setting. And you have the fact that he can't even bother to be consistent with the ages of the other characters. If you're gonna make a show where the group of characters is younger, you gotta keep all the characters the proper age level. Don't keep some like Peter Potamus, Snooper and Blabber, and McGilla Gorilla the original age. You know, I would say something bad about that, but I actually think he does a better job than the guy he's parodying. In the end, Yo Yogi was just a completely unnecessary series, which was par for the course for an air on NBC back in the day. The jokes were bad, most of the plots were either dull or had been pulled off to a much better extent than previous Hanna-Barbera properties. It's just a worthless series. If you're ever curious to see why there are no more Yogi Bear shows except for reruns on the air anymore, check this series out. Otherwise, avoid it. Because not only is it a bad show, it is also offensive.
Snag will go undercover as the Queen of England. Sheesh, what a stretch.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, a character with an eating disorder just bashed a closeted gay character with possible tendencies of cross-dressing. If that isn't proof enough that this show is bad, I don't know what is.
Yeah.
football bag.